Hi, my name is Chris, and this is Battle Nonsense. A few weeks ago, I got a message from one of my patrons, where he told me about a tweak for the Windows Registry that was very popular in the CSGO community, as many players claimed that it decreases the input lag of the keyboard. But he did suspect that this was a hoax, and so he asked if I could run a few tests. At first, I thought that I could use an Arduino and have that send a key press to the PC, as that should be good enough to test if that tweak affects the input lag of the keyboard. But since I wouldn't use an actual keyboard then, I was worried that this could lead to inconclusive results. So I quickly realized that if I want to test the input lag of a keyboard, then I must use an actual keyboard and not simulate one with an Arduino. So by using a keyboard, I would not only make sure that I get true to life results, I could then also do more tests, like how different USB polling rates affect the input lag, and test if the interrupt communication of the PS2 connection really has less input lag than USB. But what do I need to test the input lag of a keyboard? In the past, I used a Logitech G402 gaming mouse to do input lag tests with gaming monitors, as well as first-person shooters and fighting games. It was quite easy to get the mouse ready for input lag tests, as I just had to connect an LED directly to the switch of the left mouse button, since that provides the voltage required to power the LED. So to measure the input or button to pixel lag of a game, I just had to point my high-speed camera at the monitor and press the left mouse button. Inside the recorded high-speed footage, I then look for the frame where the LED turns on, and then I count the frames until I see the action triggered by that input, which then gives me the delay between the press of the button and the pixel. What I really like about this testing method is that I get true-to-life results since I use actual gaming components instead of simulating any of them. So this testing method reveals the button to pixel delay that a player is affected by, and I did want to get the same from my keyboard input lag tests. Sadly, that turned out to be much harder. If you would take your keyboard apart, then chances are that you will find rubber domes and membranes, like these here in my Logitech G19 and my Logitech G213. My testing method does not quite work on these, as I don't have the tools that are required to connect any wires here. Luckily, there are also mechanical keyboards, where underneath each key you will find a switch. So all I need is my soldering iron and get to work. But there is another problem. While the switch on my Logitech G402 gaming mouse provides enough voltage to power the LED, the switches here inside the keyboard don't. So I cannot just connect my LED to one of those switches and start testing. Now, here's how I worked around this issue. I bought a small plastic box and a two-pole push button. Then I connect the two wires to the pins of the A switch on the back of the keyboard's PCB, which you can see here in this image. So when I now press the button on my external box, then the keyboard thinks that I pressed the A key. It does not know that I did not actually press the A key on the keyboard. So now I can trigger an input. But to measure the delay, I also need a visual signal that the input was triggered. This is where that second pole of that push button comes in, as I use that to switch on an LED, which is powered by an USB charger. There's also a resistor, as the 5 volts of the charger would kill the LED, but I decided not to put that into this drawing to keep it simple. So since I did not touch the switch of the A key, I can still use that key and it will work just fine. But when I press the button on my external box, then the LED turns on and I get the letter A here inside of Notepad, as the keyboard thinks that I pressed the A key. So now that I had a working keyboard input lag test setup, I just had to point my high-speed camera at the monitor, run my tests, and then check the high-speed footage to get the delays. Now, a side effect of my testing method is that I completely removed the keyboard switches from the equation. This means that the delays I measure are not affected by how hard or fast you can press a key, or if your keyboard uses Cherry MX Black, Red, Brown, or Speed switches, which all have a different feel as well as actuation distance and force. So I think that it's good that my testing method focuses on the delay that occurs after the switch triggered the input, since that provides us with the base delay that you can't do anything about. The delay that comes from the switch, like how hard you can press the switch, or which type of switch you have in your keyboard, is literally in your own hands. So far, I have only talked about what was required to get the tests done, which I'm sorry about. But I think that it is important to explain my testing method to avoid any confusion. Also, my patrons and subscribers who followed my work in progress report on Twitter and Facebook requested a thorough explanation of my testing method, so I hope you can understand why I did that. Now, what did I test exactly? Modern keyboards use an USB connection, which offers polling rates of 125, 250, 500 and 1000 Hz. So at a polling rate of 125 Hz, the PC asks the keyboard 125 times per second about its current state, like if a key was pressed since they talked the last time. The communication of the ancient PS2 connector, which you can still find even on high-end gaming mainboards, is interrupt-based. This means that a key press is sent to the PC almost immediately and interrupts what the PC is doing at the moment. The theory that many gamers hold on to is that this provides lower delays than the polling of the USB connection. There are also PS2 to USB adapters, which are used to test the PS2 connection. These do not have any electronics inside, as you can see here in this image where I cut one open for you. When you connect an USB keyboard to such an adapter, then the keyboard switches from polling to interrupt. However, many if not most modern keyboards do not support these adapters anymore. Now, to do all these different tests, I bought three keyboards. The Cherry MXBoard 3.0, which uses an USB connection and does neither include nor work with a PS2 adapter. It also has an USB polling rate of 125 Hz, which I was told by the Cherry support. I had to reach out to them as there was no information on this keyboard's polling rate, which also means that if the specifications of your keyboard do not explicitly mention an USB polling rate of more than 125 Hz, then it will probably run at just 125 Hz. The second test keyboard is a Cherry G80-3000, which also uses USB but comes with a PS2 adapter. And just like the MXBoard 3.0, it also uses an USB polling rate of 125 Hz according to the Cherry support. Keyboard number 3 is a Corsair K70 Rapid Fire RGB, which uses USB and does not work when connected to a PS2 adapter. It also has a switch that allows you to select a specific polling rate. 1 means 1 millisecond delay or 1000 Hz, 2 means 2 milliseconds delay or 500 Hz, 4 stands for 4 milliseconds or 250 Hz, and 8 will set the polling rate to 8 milliseconds or 125 Hz. You can also check the active polling rate inside the Corsair software. So all these keyboards got my special treatment where I connected two wires to the pins of the A switch on the back of the PCB, and to be able to quickly connect and disconnect my external test box, I simply used a 3.5 mm audio extension cable, as you can see here in these images. Now let's finally take a look at the results of hundreds of high-speed input lag tests that I did with these keyboards. In my first test, I simply set the desktop refresh rate to 180 Hz and then fired up Notepad. Then I measured the delay between pressing the button on my test box and the letter A showing up on the monitor. In the second test, I had CSGO run at 300 FPS with minimum graphic settings and a display refresh rate of 180 Hz with VSync and G-Sync disabled. I then measured the time between pressing the button on the external test box and my player model responding to that input. So, with the Cherry MXBoard 3.0, I measured an average input lag of 39 milliseconds in Notepad and about the same in CSGO. The Cherry G80-3000 showed 1 millisecond more delay on average, but I'd argue that this could be inside the margin of error. So these are the delays while using USB, but when I connected the Cherry G80-3000 to the PS2 adapter, I noticed about 9 milliseconds less delay on average in Notepad and about 11 milliseconds less delay on average in CSGO, so the PS2 connection really has less input lag. However, when you then take a look at my results from the Corsair K70, then this keyboard crushes the PS2 results even when it runs at a polling rate of just 125 Hz. Again, the keyboard switches don't make a difference here as I explained earlier in this video, so if you skipped that part then please go back and watch the entire video to understand what these numbers here mean. So how can the input lag of the Corsair K70 be that much lower at the same polling rate? I guess that this shows us that they simply use superior electronics inside the keyboard, which detects the key press much quicker than any of these other boards. After all, the input lag of a keyboard is not only affected by how fast you can get the data to the PC, but also by how fast the keyboard can detect the key press internally and then get that data ready for transfer to the PC. That applies to both USB and PS2 connections. Now, what happens when I increase the polling rate from 125 Hz to 1000 Hz? In theory, that should reduce the input lag by another 7 milliseconds. However, I only measured 3 milliseconds less delay on average in both Notepad and CSGO. I did use the Corsair software to make sure that the polling rate changed, and I restarted CSGO every time I changed the polling rate. But even after I rebooted the PC to make sure that the keyboard and Windows were using the new polling rate, I still got a delay decrease of only 3 milliseconds, not the theoretical 7 milliseconds. So, as expected, the rates in between also show only minor improvements to the delays. That said, a delay of 14.6 milliseconds on average is really good and nothing that you can seriously complain about, especially when you consider that we have 5.5 milliseconds between two frames at a display refresh rate of 180 Hz. Now, how about that Windows Registry tweak I mentioned earlier that should reduce the input lag of keyboards? Well, as you can see here, it does not work at all, and those who said that it did work for them were simply suffering from the placebo effect, which just shows how powerful your imagination can be if you really want to believe something. So, what can we learn from these tests? If you have an old keyboard that works when you plug it into a PS2 adapter, then this will slightly reduce the input lag of your keyboard, but I'm not sure that you will be able to notice that. When you buy a new keyboard, then try to find out which polling rate it supports. If you can't find that information anywhere in the specifications, then the keyboard will most likely use a polling rate of just 125 Hz. That said, the input lag of a gaming keyboard from a decent brand might not be too bad, even when it has a polling rate of just 125 Hz, but I would have to test such a keyboard to know for sure. When it comes to mechanical keyboards, then the key switches make a big difference. As a gamer, you might be tempted to jump on a keyboard which uses switches that have a very short actuation distance, like the Cherry MX speed switches, but you might find that with these you frequently mistype or mistrigger a key, as resting your thumb on the spacebar can cause enough pressure to have your character jump. If you want to buy a mechanical keyboard, then always go to a store and type on different keyboards for a while to find out which switch type you like the most. So again, I want to apologize for the length of this video and how much time I spent on explaining what was required to get these keyboard input lag tests done. But I feel that this was necessary to avoid any confusion, and it was requested by my patrons and subscribers. I also want to make clear that this video was not sponsored by Cherry nor Corsair. Everything considered, this video took more than 40 hours to make, and it was only possible thanks to the support of my patrons, as I had to buy all the required hardware myself, since my channel is just too small and the view count on my videos too low, for companies like Corsair to send me hardware for free that I can keep and torture with my soldering iron. So if you enjoyed this video and like what I'm doing here, then it would be great if you could support me on Patreon, as YouTube's ad revenue is sadly not enough anymore to run a niche channel like mine. Without the awesome support that I get from my patrons, Battle Nonsense would not exist anymore. You can find a link to my Patreon in the description down below, where you will also find links to my social accounts in case that you want to stay up to date on the videos that I'm working on. So if you enjoyed this video, then please give it a like, subscribe for more, and I hope to see you next time. Until then, have a nice day and take care. My name is Chris, and this was Battle Nonsense.